welcome. It's nice to see a good crowd and kind of a gray Friday morning, and it's nice that you all could get here. I want to acknowledge some folks who've been very helpful in putting this event together. Oh, by the way, I'm Addison Woodward, and I'm a board member on the Center of Tax and Budget Accountability. So from Loyola, a good friend and colleague, David Prossy, was instrumental in kind of greasing the skids so we could have this event here. And he worked with two of his good friends and important people, David Van Zite and John Pellicerio. I should try my Italian with him. It's getting a little rusty. And the Center for Tax and Budget Accountability Committee that helped create this. We've had many meetings. Kathy Nesberg, Jean Sussman, Marlise Trover, Jane Lehman, David May, and Carlene Lutz. So welcome. I'm going to call the Provost, John Pellicerio, here to give you a really proper welcome from Loyola. Thank you.
Thank you, Addison. Good morning and welcome to Loyola University Chicago. I want to extend a warm welcome to everyone who is here. All of you who I know care deeply about the state of higher education in Illinois and have gathered here today to delve into some of the issues, serious issues, that confront us as citizens, taxpayers, and stakeholders in higher education. You're at Loyola's Water Tower campus, which is home to our professional schools of law, and this is the law school's building, business, communication, social work, and education. Among Loyola's 16,500 students, about 11,000 are undergraduates. Many of them do study here, but the bulk of our undergraduates are up at our other Chicago campus on the lakeshore in Rogers Park. Also, just next door, I want to highlight our newest school, Arupe College, which was created last year, so they're just in their second year of operation, offering an associate's degree to about 315 students. All of these students are what we would classify as Pell Grant eligible in terms of their families' incomes. 97% are students of color, and I might add that 63 of those students are undocumented students that we are supporting. We started this college at the very time that things were starting to go south or further south in Illinois with our state budget, but we think this is about access to higher education for a group that is typically underrepresented, and we're committed to helping them get associate's degree, and next year we'll be transitioning the first set of graduates to baccalaureate degree institutions. We have over 1,000 students at Loyola who are pursuing their own degrees in education, from teacher preparation for elementary and secondary schools to school psychology, school social work, and higher education. And all want to contribute to the enhancement of learning in the state of Illinois. But what a difficult time to be thinking about education in our state. As the chief academic officer here, I'm keenly aware of the changing landscape of higher education. As higher education itself enters a period of uncertainty, any number of issues contribute to sleeplessness on the part of those of us who work in colleges and universities. The demographic shifts that are taking place that will shrink the pool of college-bound high school graduates. A growing national concern regarding the affordability of a college degree. relentless media reports questioning the quality and outcomes of our enterprise, reports of rising student debt and loan defaults, and greater scrutiny of the higher education enterprise from federal and state governments, as well as by regional accrediting agencies. And then in Illinois, the challenge is multiplied. These past 2 years, as we all know, have been particularly challenging for those of us in higher education. The absence of a state budget, the delays, cuts, and uncertainty in MAP funding for our neediest students, and the loss of our talent, our graduates, our faculty, our professional staffs who have left Illinois or higher education for more stable environments, affects all of us in deep ways. I'm concerned about our students who can't rely on the certainty of MAP. I'm worried about the flight of our most talented. And I'm frustrated, as are most of you, by the seemingly endless stalemate in Springfield among our political leaders. But my broader concern is about the impact that this environment is having on the brand of higher education in Illinois. Regardless of whether we have a stake in one of the large public universities, the struggling regional colleges, or private universities in this state, we are all at risk of seeing our distinctive positioning, our perceived value, our contribution to producing talent, and our reputations suffer as a result of the state of Illinois' budget crisis. Despite the challenges, I hope that your resolve, like mine, remains constant. Our colleges and universities can and should continue to play the very critical role of preparing our graduates to become engaged and educated citizens, secure meaningful employment in Illinois, assume positions of responsibility and leadership, and contribute to a greater social good. I take pride and satisfaction from knowing that we can make a difference through our work and in and on behalf of higher education in Illinois. So thank you for convening your gathering here on Loyola's campus. Thanks for all that you do in support of higher education, and I look forward to hearing the perspectives and expertise that will be shared today. Thank you.
Well, good morning. My name is Ralph Martiri. I'm Executive Director of the Bipartisan Center for Tax and Budget Accountability. And if you're not familiar with our organization, I mean, we really are bipartisan, which kind of means my board of directors doesn't necessarily like or trust each other very much. But that's a fantastic thing for us at staff, right? It allows us to focus on best practices and data. And really, ideological underpinnings don't matter to us. We look at what the research indicates is the appropriate way to address a problem, and we focus on that. Now, today, we're going to present our findings on what has been going on with the state and its investment in higher education. And I had a hard time thinking about how I was going to open this discussion, because really, higher education is a little more narrowly focused than what people generally think about when they think about the public sector. So I wanted to put it in context of our state. Our state spends, generally, $9 out of $10 on four things: education, health, social services, and public safety. This is where the state invests its money. And higher ed is a subset of that education category. It's everything from early childhood on through K-12, et cetera. And increasingly, higher education and attaining a degree — it could be a two-year degree, it could be a four-year degree — but attaining that degree has become essential for someone to become really a productive member of society, not just as a member of our democracy, but really someone that can earn a livelihood. The data are pretty much compelling here. On a straight line basis, when you look at it — doesn't matter if you're looking at Chicago, Illinois, the Midwest, or the nation — as educational attainment increases, unemployment rate decreases. That's just the fact. But interestingly enough, it's not just unemployment rate that's so strongly correlated with educational attainment. It is also wage. In fact, since 1980, the only cohort of workers in America that have seen their incomes increase at a rate greater than inflation actually have a college degree. Everyone else is earning less today, on average, than they did in 1980. And in Illinois, that's a particular challenge. Why? Two-thirds plus of our high school graduates are not college ready. Two-thirds. So when they enter the playing field for higher education, they generally need remediation to be able to complete a degree. So what we're seeing in our state is a failure to recognize the importance of education all the way from preschool through 20. We have a council on that. We have had commissions on that. Heck, we just had a governor deliver a state of the state address where he said what he cared about was that every child in our state receive a quality education and that our major research institutions can expand their footprint, his words, and do more. How does any public sector institution expand its footprint, do more with less capacity? Fiscal policy might be a pretty boring thing, but there's one truism here that no one will be able to deny. If you have inadequate capacity from a resource standpoint on the front end, you will get inadequate outcomes on your back end. Period, end of story. Sure, you need to invest your resources wisely. Sure, you need to implement best practices. But if you don't have the resources to begin with, your outcomes are going to be questionable. And here's the problem with that. How many times have you heard elected officials in our state discuss the capacity side of the ledger? They're happy to talk about outcomes. You're not generating the outcomes we want, universities, colleges, schools. But they don't want you to ask the question, did we invest in our education system the resources that system needs to generate the outcomes we want, to educate our population? And what I'm going to show you is the data make it very clear the answer is no. Now, why that's such a bad idea, why we should be making the investment? All the data keeps showing these correlations between educational attainment and economic viability. Look, according to the BLS, unemployment rate for dropouts nationally is almost three times that of those with a four-year degree. From 1979 to 2012, for states to be really strong in growth of productivity, they had to have the highest number of both high school and college grads. The data are compelling there. In fact, the states with the best high school and college completion rates had the highest per capita incomes in the nation. When you look at all the data here, and there's a lot of noise about a state government, its design, its investment, its tax policy, and how it relates to the economy. When you separate out the noise and look at the research, there are only two things a state government can do to grow its economy at a faster rate than other states, and at a faster rate than what its share of the national GDP would suggest it should grow at. Invest in infrastructure and invest in education, and that is education writ large, pre-K through 20. All the research shows the states that have done those two things the best have had faster growth in median income, better high wage growth, faster growth in state GDP per capita, better job growth than the states who haven't. Tax policy, how you tax yourself, there is no statistically meaningful correlation between your tax policy and your economic growth, period. None. There's none at the state level. There's none at the federal level. So all these naysayers who maintain if we increase taxes to the point needed to actually make the investments we should be making in important matters like education infrastructure, if we raise those taxes, we're going to harm our economy. There's not one shred of evidence to support it. Not a one. So it's time our informed members of the community, our decision influencers, start pushing back on elected officials on this really crucial point. So I found this compelling. There's always been a wage gap between high school graduates and college graduates. It has doubled in the last 30 years. So in 1979, and you can see right up here, the wage gap between someone with a college diploma and a high school diploma was 23.5%. It's now over 46%. Same goes advanced degree. That's doubled. You can't find one meaningful statistic that looks at education and its correlation to economic viability and not find this kind of meaningful relationship. It's really important nowadays to make this additional investment, to have a university and college system that could meet the needs of your population. That's what you need. Modern economy requires it. So what have we been doing with funding higher education in Illinois? Most people in this room sadly know the answer to that. I'm going to rub it in a little bit. By law, the Illinois Board of Higher Education every year has to submit to both the governor and the General Assembly a request for appropriate funding levels for higher education. And you can see that since 2008, the state has failed to fund the requested level of investment put on the table by the Board of Higher Ed. Now that's interesting in and of itself, but it really doesn't tell the whole story of how complete the disinvestment in higher education has been in the state of Illinois. Let's look at general fund appropriations over the long haul from 2000 to 2015. This is interesting stuff right here. Here are those core service areas broken out even by subcategory, right? Healthcare, Medicaid, pre-K through 12 education, higher ed, social services, public safety. Look at the higher ed line. After you adjust for inflation, our 2015 budget for higher ed was 41 points below where it was in 2000. 2015, by the way, is an interesting year. It's the last year the state of Illinois actually bothered to pass a general fund budget. We are now halfway through our second consecutive fiscal year of the General Assembly and the governor failing to get that little constitutional obligation satisfied. But look a little deeper at those numbers. Higher ed uniquely is the only core service that received less in nominal dollar funding in 2015 than it did in 2000. So even if you never adjusted for inflation, the state just in nominal dollars was investing less in higher ed in 2015. Someone needs to defend that decision-making process to me, because I really don't see any data that would support a public policy position that suggests that's a rational thing to do when you're looking at your state resources and you're deciding on where to invest them. Oh, but wait, there's more. That was the good news. Then comes 2016. Now, this was the first fiscal year in the history of the state of Illinois where we never got a final comprehensive budget passed for the state. In fact, fully two-thirds of the spending on current services were authorized by either court order or consent decree. So what that really means, by the way, is it never went through the standard budget process, so there was no public vote, there was no consideration, there was no discussion, there was no governor signing off or vetoing. There was no transparency or accountability. A court-ordered spending. Now, there were some appropriations signed and passed into law for 2016. They were pretty much for education. We got a pre-K budget, we got a K-12 budget, and we got a higher ed budget. Of course, what we decided at state level to invest in higher education in the year 2016 was fully 67% less than what higher education got in 2015. 67% cut, year-to-year cut. And in 2015, the nominal dollar appropriation for higher education was less than it was 15 years prior. So despite all the data showing the significant importance to the economy of investing in a higher education system that will meet the needs of your population, Illinois made the fiscal decision, and this did go through the General Assembly and was signed into law by the governor, to cut higher ed on a year-to-year basis from 15 to 16 by two-thirds. There you go. Not surprisingly, this consistent, now since 2000, trend to disinvest in higher education has resulted in Illinois becoming a national outlier when compared to other states. So from 2015 to 2016, 37 states in America actually increased on a year-to-year basis their investment in higher ed. And Illinois is one of only four states in America that cut higher education funding in both fiscal years 2015 and 2016. One of only four. So now, looking from the Great Recession forward, because after the Great Recession, many states, in fact, cut their funding for higher education. But Illinois, in its self-imposed race to the bottom, is one of only nine states in America that's cut higher ed funding by 30% or more since the Great Recession in 08. So this disinvestment isn't something that you just look at from a state perspective. I think when you compare us to the rest of the country, you really see how dramatic the scaling back of financial support for universities and colleges in this state has been. Little more context. Illinois has the fifth largest population of any state in America. We have the fifth largest economy. Our state's economy is $750 billion. You mean to tell me we can't invest what the Board of Higher Education is asking us to invest in education, $2 billion? Not even a rounding error in our state economy when you look at it in context. We can't do that? We can't raise the revenue to do that with a $750 billion economy? The decision at the state level for generations to be artificially low tax, because Illinois, once again, despite being the fifth biggest state in the country, has consistently ranked in the bottom 10 in total state and local tax burden as a percentage of income. That decision to be so low tax is more important than investing in higher ed, K-12, and I'm not even getting into what's going on with the social services network in this state and some of the other things that are really suffering because of the cuts being implemented at the state level. Let's just keep it on education. When you put the data together, there just is no way to see this decision-making process as rational or beneficial for anyone. All right, and then there's 2017. There's a moderate year-to-year bump in higher ed funding this year. We got about 70 million more, woohoo, than we did in 2016. Remember, 2016 was such a monstrous cut. What we decided to do is look at the long term. What does that funding for higher education in 2017 look like compared to 2000? Well, in nominal dollars, it's pretty significantly less. But to get to the real impact, we adjusted for inflation, it's almost 80% less. So our current funding for higher education as of right now is 80% less in real terms than what it was in the year 2000. Not surprisingly then, our change in per student funding for higher education is down there at the bottom. These are the 15 largest states in America, and you can see Illinois is down there number two in cuts in per student funding in higher ed, 54% over the 08-2015 sequence. We are way, way down in the nation. So what are the chances things get better? Let me think about it, not good. So one of the main reasons Illinois has its fiscal problems is its tax policy is so poorly designed. It's had a structural imbalance, and it's had this structural imbalance for a very long period of time. All that means, and this is our model, and by the way, one interesting thing about this model, so I don't like to use models when I do presentations, because your assumptions can jury-rig your outcomes, right? So a smart statistician could find a way. I mean, what did Winston Churchill famously say, right? There are three kinds of lies, goddamn lies, and statistics. So what we try to do is use just basic math and publicly available data sets. However, when you project forward, you do need to have some sort of model. So this was peer-reviewed, you should know, by four different independent academics at universities across the state of Illinois. It was also peer-reviewed by the head of state and local tax at the GAO in Washington, D.C. It passed completely peer review. The assumptions we used are the exact same the Congressional Budget Office uses when it projects fiscal matters forward. That is, no change in law, start from a balanced budget point, average rates of inflation, average rates of economic growth, average rates of population change. If Illinois actually had a balanced budget in 2015, our starting point here, which is last year we had a comprehensive budget, and it did not, by the way, it had an accumulated deficit of $5.97 billion, but if it did, would its revenues continue to support the level of services provided in 2015, plus the debt load the state had incurred? Well, the blue bar, gray bar there, that's the cost of services and debt load over time. You can see there's been some cuts to current services. The red bar is what our revenue system is going to generate. And the gap between revenue growth and service cost growth is the structural imbalance, literally built into the structure of how we tax versus the cost of the services we provide and the debt we've incurred. The bottom line here is, there is no new money to be putting into higher education unless we change tax policy. It's inescapable. And remember, this sort of softens the blow because the starting point of the assumption is that we had a balanced budget. We had a $5.97 billion deficit. And that deficit grew significantly from 2015 to 16, despite the cuts the state implemented to current services. So here's our walkthrough on that. And I think it's a pretty eye-opening thing. You start with our revenue for 2016, $32 billion. And then there was hard costs we had to pay by law. Those come right off of the top, right? Leaving $20 billion to spend on current services. But wait, out of that $20 billion, you do have to pay your deficit carry forward, so that has to come out, leaving $14 billion. We went to try to spend $24 on services. We only had $14 billion in revenue. That meant the deficit grew from 5.9 to 9.1. And that's with significant cuts in spending. Now, the reason it's growing from that prior chart is that decline in revenue from the phase down of the temporary tax increase. So the truth of the matter is, if Illinois wants to have a better tomorrow from a capacity standpoint for investing in higher education, it needs to raise taxes. And raising taxes adequately to meet our needs, and not just for higher education, but for the panoply of services the state provides, costs somewhere in the $6.5 to $7.5 billion range, or literally 1% of our state's economic activity. That is an overall tax increase which is so small, it can't be measured. And that's what's standing in the way of this state fixing its fiscal problems and making appropriate investments in everything, including higher education, so that maybe we can move our economy forward. Now on that, I'm going to bring up Danielle Stanley of the Center, and I don't know if you know Danielle, she's relatively new to us, so I'm going to brag about her for 2 seconds. She's the principal author and researcher of this report, and she has added tremendous value to our organization since she's joined it. So Danielle, you're up.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you all for being here today to get a better understanding on the current state of higher education in Illinois. My portion of the presentation will go into the specific cuts for each public university, starting with the fiscal year comparison for fiscal year 2017 to 2015 in nominal dollars. As you can see, University of Illinois had the largest cut in total dollars, which is a total of $297 million, while Chicago State University had the largest cut in percentage, which is 65%. This is very startling for Chicago State University because it's predominantly serves Black students in the south side of Chicago. It's an economic engine, provides a lot of jobs, and so this cut was very detrimental to Chicago State University. And historically, in higher education institutions that serves predominantly minority students, oftentimes always gets appropriated in low amounts. Chicago State only received $36 million for fiscal year 2015. They always receive, historically for the past decade, lower compared to any other university. And Northeastern is in the same boat as well. Let's talk about the capacity issues. We all know the numbers, we've all seen the negatives and everything, but we're gonna just provide highlights from media outlets that were done over the course of the budget impasse and still happening. Illinois State University cut its instructional budget by $1 million between fiscal year 2015 and fiscal year 2016. And so that means they probably had to lay off faculty members, condense classes, not offer as many courses for the academic school year. Chicago State University laid off 40% of their workforce, non-faculty positions. In the spring of 2016, they originally sent off 900 layoff notices to both faculty and non-faculty members. But in the end, Chicago State University laid off 409 faculty positions. They're also on the brink of closing their doors. In return, they just ended their school semester early for spring 2016 by eliminating their spring break. Western Illinois University had to lay off 145 non-faculty positions in Macomb, Illinois. Western is one of the largest employers in Macomb, so this is very detrimental to the community, and it will be have like multiplier effects that will still happen. And also for Western, they had to eliminate four academic programs due to low enrollment: African American studies, philosophy, religious studies, and women's studies were eliminated at Western Illinois University. And at a time of this new administration where women's rights is being questioned, it's kind of sad that Western had to eliminate that program and African American studies. And so I'd like to get a better understanding and see what is the culture on that campus now because those programs have been eliminated. University of Illinois eliminated 484 non-instructional staff positions, and that's including University of Illinois at Chicago, as well as University of Illinois at Springfield. U of I is in a special category because they have a large sum of reserves. It's a research-based institution. They receive a lot of federal grants. So even though they did have to lay off people and do hiring freezes, they're still in a better shape compared to institutions like Chicago State University or Northeastern University. And in Eastern Illinois University at Charleston, they had to lay off 177 civil service employees as well. Sad stuff here. So just this chart essentially explains how each institution depends on the state for their general fund budget. As you can see from one example, Chicago State University relies 32% on the state for their budget. And we saw that detrimental cut of 65%. So there is a strong possibility that Chicago State may close their doors. They're still in talks of it in the media outlets as well. Let's see. University of Illinois receives 15% of their budget from the state of Illinois. In a report by the Center for Budget and Policy Priorities, they reported that U of I received 30 to 40% of state funding between the year of 1960 to 1990. And as you can see, in 2014, that has changed dramatically to 15%. The state is continuing to disinvest in higher education. And the outcomes shows that we're laying off positions, we're eliminating academic programs, we're going to increase tuition, we're going to dip into the reserves. And so all this is, you know, happening and taking place. And certain universities can rely on out-of-state tuition or international tuition rates, like University of Illinois or Southern Illinois University. But an institution like Governor State at University Park in the South Suburbs, they have 0% of international students that they can rely on for that tuition assistance. That's not? What's the percentage? Okay, the data is from 2014, so thank you for the clarity. And the size of endowment per student is $410. And endowment is very important because this offers scholarship opportunities for students, for those who, for academic, or if they are needing of financial assistance as well. And so University of Illinois had the largest endowment per student of $26,000. Now we're going to look at the tuition growth rate at national universities from 1990 to 2015. As you can see, private universities have increased their tuition over that time sequence from 1995 to 2015. Public out-of-state came in second, but the least inexpensive institution is to attend public in-state universities. However, the state of Illinois is the top five the top five in the country with the highest tuition rates. In-state tuition in Illinois has increased of range by 50 to 100% over the past decade. That means tuition increases in that range not only outstrip inflation, but also the rate of growth of income. So families who want to send their child to a university may not even have the financial capacity to do so because tuition is just increasing at an exponential amount between 50 to 100%. And due to the lack of state funding, there is going to be a continued rise in tuition growth because the university, because the state of Illinois is just not properly investing in higher education. Now, just a breakdown of Illinois Public University tuition 2016-2017 year. As you can see, University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign is the most expensive public institution in Illinois, $31,000, and their out-of-state tuition is $46,000. But if you go to U of I Springfield, which is my alma mater, it was only $11,000. It was a little bit cheaper than when I was a student there, but it's the cheapest out of the three institutions for the U of I system. Now, because of rising tuition rates, universities, students are forced to take out student loans, and it's more pronounced in African-American communities, African-American households. From 1989 to 2013, we see a rising increase in students, households taking out student loans. Currently, the national debt is $1.3 trillion of student loans, and that's regardless of race and gender, everybody's taking out student loans because tuition is just increasing so high. But African Americans are, it's 41% of African Americans are more likely to take out student loans. And and they have a lower return on investment from that borrowing because of issues like discrimination in the labor market as well. For instance, some employers do credit checks when they look at it, a possible candidate for a position. And if a new graduate has an outstanding balance of student loan debt and does not have the financial capacity to pay that back, and they go into forbearance or they go into deferment, that, you know, hurts their credit score, and so that might take them out of that possible job opportunity. And that is one of the possibilities of how African Americans are kind of barred from the labor market when they have these discriminatory labor practices. And because of high tuition rates, that is a new trend, and as well as student debt being taken out of, students now are contemplating whether or not they should attend higher education institutions, especially in Illinois because of the budget impasse and the uncertainty of MAP and financial assistance. Chicago State University suffered the biggest blow of student enrollment, which was their student enrollment has declined by 25%. Their freshman class for fall 2016 was only 89 students. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine keeping your doors open at a higher education institution with only 89 students and 40% of your workforce is gone? University of Illinois at Springfield, University of Illinois at Chicago, and Illinois State University, all three of these schools have moderately low tuition, have seen a small increase in their student enrollment as well. So not everything is all negative. There has been some silver lining in this. Students do want to go to institutions, but it just has to be affordable. But the main trend is students are leaving Illinois to attend institutions to other states. Let's see. In 2015 to 2016, 16,000 students left Illinois to go to other schools in other states, while only 2,000 students from out of state came to Illinois to enroll in public universities. And in 2015 to 2016, 5,500 fewer students enrolled in Illinois public universities. So these numbers are startling. Student enrollment is on the decline while tuition rates are on the increase. And we're talking about the monetary MAP program, which is financial assistance for undergraduate students, for those who are low income, but they're in a good academic standing. And the average award amount is $2,500 per semester. So even though it is a great asset to students to attend college, it's not enough to subsidize your education. If your tuition is $30,000, like a U of I Urbana-Champaign, this is not even gonna cover your room and board at all. And so, what I want to ask for is just an increase in MAP funding for students to attend. And also, MAP awards do not go to undocumented immigrants as well. They do not get to become eligible for MAP programs. And the final slide is just showing that the unemployment rate by race and education level between blacks and whites, despite the American dream of getting a degree and you're earning higher wages, is just simply not true in the data. According to the Economic Policy Institute, African American college graduates are the only group of college educated workers who have an unemployment rate closely to the national unemployment rate, which is 5.3%. So even with this degree, we still don't have a high rate of return compared to our white counterparts. And so that is a racial disparity that needs to be addressed. And on top of that, we're taking out a significant amount of loans and we're just not getting a high rate on our return. And so that's the final slide so we can begin the panel discussion. So thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Becky Vivi. I'm an education reporter with WBEZ, and I apologize, I'm on like the back end of a cold right now, so not up to perfect voice right now, but I'll let everyone get seated. All right, thank you all for being here. And just, I'll do a quick brief introduction of who's on our panel today. We have Tom Cross, he's the chair of the Illinois Board of Higher Education. Juwan Hall, UIC student trustee. Ralph Martieri, who you all heard from. John Miller, who's the president of the University Professionals of Illinois Local 4100.
Got it.
Yes. And then Kyle Westbrook, executive director of the Partnership for College Completion. And I'm going to just start, jump right in. The presentation we just heard can make this problem feel almost insurmountable. There are a lot of things that need to be fixed, but let's go and just, I'm going to ask each of one of you to give us your view of where to start. Where do we start to sort of turn this around? And don't say pass a budget, because we all agree that we need to pass a state budget. But where should we start to kind of help turn things around and improve the state of higher education in Illinois? Okay, let's start. Go ahead.
I'll start. It's a crisis in higher education, but it's also a crisis in leadership. And it's a crisis in leadership that is born out of a sense in this state that the crisis in higher education doesn't impact all of us. The thing that jumped out to me in the presentation that Ralph and Danielle had just finished is the disproportionality of this problem, the disproportionality in terms of its impact, that the students who are in most need in this state are the students who are most disproportionately impacted by this higher education crisis. So to me, I take this as a call to arms, and really, we should be as a city, as a state, as a region, we should be as pissed off about this as we are about other issues that we are in the streets about. We should understand that our long-term economic health in this state is being seriously impaired by our inability to fund higher education. And so, to me, it starts with a basic awareness on the part of everyone in this state that the higher education crisis is not just a crisis that impacts poor students and low-income students who are obviously disproportionately higher enrolled in state universities and community colleges, but it will long-term impact all of us as our economic growth in this state is stagnated. So to me, it starts with this conversations like this, but broadening this conversation through media veins and through organization on campus and off campus, and folks who are our biggest champions in the business community, biggest champions in government, biggest champions in the public sector and in other areas of life, getting as upset about this as we are about cuts to social services and other institutions in the state.
Mm-hmm. Tom?
So you have several things going on, and my struggle is in the board of as chair of the board of higher ed, are there several struggles, more than several, quite a few. But I think you have to be a little careful in this conversation of you have every right to be angry as a student, as a parent, as a, you know, a restaurant owner in one of these college towns that's losing business. I mean, and the list goes on and on. But you have to find this balance, because if we are too strong in voicing our opposition, which again I get that, and believe me I do, but then do you get to a point where you just turn everybody off and they say, well, it's so bad, and it is bad, that I'm not going to even look at an Illinois school. I'm going to go, and we already are seeing that now, my out-migration numbers, where people are looking at Indiana and Missouri and Wisconsin and Michigan, and I get worried that gets even worse and worse and worse. So I'm not sure where the fine line is about trying to make your case like you did and you are, and how far you go on that. And I don't think you can ignore, Becky, the issue of the budget. You had a trend of reductions in money to higher ed before this budget impasse, and it's been exacerbated by the budget impasse. But what's happened is you've got almost a state of paralysis in the world of higher ed in addressing college completion or adult learners. So you really do have to get that budget done in order to move on in some of these other substantive areas. The thing for me that's really problematic is MAP funding. Mm-hmm. We in 2000, 2001, if my numbers are correct in what I've read, we were able to take care of just about every student who had a MAP need. Today, we're at about a third. We really need about $1 billion to adequately take care of MAP. And you could probably, maybe my numbers are off, but I don't think they are. We did about 350, I think the numbers are on 320, 330. The Board of Higher Ed this year raised our suggested number by $100 million for MAP because I felt like it was, that area is an area that we really need to improve on. Not that everything else isn't important, all right? I'm not suggesting the other things aren't important, operations, et cetera. But I think MAP for me is one of the biggest issues in this state of making sure we take care of kids. The idea of kids getting out of school, students getting out of school with huge loans is very problematic. But think about the children, their students that say to themselves, I can't get MAP, so I'm not gonna go to school, college when I get out of college, when I get out of high school. There's a good chance they're never gonna go to college if they miss that first or second year. That's almost a crime. And I think MAP is a huge, huge issue.
Ralph?
It is.
Where do we start?
Not almost.
Yeah, I completely agree with, frankly, what both Kyle and Tom have just said. But as I look at it, I think the whole discussion needs to be changed. So, you know, this shouldn't be a partisan issue. It is absolutely not a partisan issue. If you could take elected officials out of the milieu of Springfield and just get them to focus on the facts here, and the important correlations between higher education and economic viability for the state, I think you would get the vast majority of folks in both parties to say, wait a minute, we need to improve this and make a better investment. I've yet to meet the person running for public office that says I'm the anti-economy candidate. You know, I'm the one here, boy, you elect me, I'm gonna tank the whole thing. So it really transcends the two parties' interests, and I think it's one way to change the discussion. I think, frankly, another way to change the discussion is to focus on some of the civil rights aspects here. I mean, we talk about civil rights in a number of different ways, but we rarely talk about it in a higher education lens. But truly, when you look at those correlations between educational attainment and wage and unemployment rate, it's a core civil rights issue. I mean, if we're serious about investing in our population, and in particular our low-income population, to give them the opportunity to become self-sufficient middle-income earners or above, we better be investing in our institutions of higher learning. And quite frankly, we'd better be investing in those institutions in higher learning that do a really good job of serving those populations. I mean, a very recent study that just came out a week ago showed how powerfully community colleges and universities that do focus on lower to middle income kids move them up the income ladder post-graduation. This isn't theoretical, it's reality. So we need to change the conversation. And Becky, I have to say, we do have to have a budget. I mean, it's,
I know.
It's literally should not be accepted by any voter or taxpayer in this state that our General Assembly and Governor can't meet their constitutional obligation to deliver a budget. And one of the things that concerns me about the most recent conversation there, and then I will shut up because people have heard me talk too much already, is the talk of a balanced budget. Are you kidding me? We're looking at an accumulated deficit north of $9 billion. Now it's pushing in 2017. That was at the end of 16, north of 10, 11. If you were to balance the budget without passing a massive tax increase...
Ralph, can you lean in just a little bit so people can hear?
Oh, if you were to balance the budget without passing a massive tax increase, frankly, you'd harm communities across the state. It would do so much damage, and much of that damage would not be remediable in the future, that it'd be one of the worst things they could do. So I think we need a rational discussion on the budget. You should look for long-term balance. That long-term balance should include adequate revenue to support the level of services that we need to satisfy the demands driven by our population. It's period, it's that simple. And frankly, the cost of doing it is very low in context of our economy. Once again, change the discussion.
$7 billion, are you nuts? Well, it's 1%. It's 1% of our state's economy. It can't be measured, it's so small. Don't let something so small it can't be measured stand in the way of solving our problems. So we have to change this discussion. We really do have to make it one where folks, irrespective of their worldview, can support a rational outcome that involves generating adequate resources to make core investments in needed services.
I completely agree with everything the rest of the panel just said, but I really want to kind of, I guess, hone in on everything you just said, Ralph, that we do need more conversation around this as an economic issue, right? I think specifically here in Illinois, I guess, it's probably not specific to Illinois, but we oftentimes politicize economic issues, and it hinders us from doing, from really being what we're capable of doing. It hinders us from maximizing our potential as a state. The University of Illinois, we recently did a study and we saw that we have a 19% return on every single dollar that the state gives us. There's not a single CD, IRA, or financial instrument that I'm aware of that can give you a 19% return on an investment right now. So to not fund higher ed is economically irresponsible. And it baffles my mind to like look at this report and see these numbers in the direction that they're going. One thing I will say, I guess, as far as like being able to move forward, one thing that we've done as a university, we recently announced in conjunction with a bipartisan group of legislators, a proposal to guarantee funding for the University of Illinois, I believe it's for 5 years, in return for guarantees on outcomes to the state. Every university can't do that, though. Every university doesn't have the prestige that the University of Illinois has. Every university doesn't have access to the network that the University of Illinois has. And so for us, while we may see some universities manage or maintain throughout this current crisis that we're going through, but in the end, just like we've said, and again, getting back to what you said, this has a civil rights issue, the students who are losing are those who are at the margins, those who are already trying to play catch up, those who are already behind. And so if we continue to do this and we continue to make these cuts, what does that say about us? All right, what does that say about the direction that we're moving in? Are we really moving forward or are we just putting our hands up in the air? So.
John?
So, read this report. It was pretty depressing in a sense, and I suspect many of you who have read the report, I suspect many of you who have read this report also have that reaction. But what you're seeing in this report really is just the top side. We're not seeing the real impact, and this report doesn't really get into, I think, the impact that this is having on the campuses. So it's not just a question of PR that we're scaring our students away. The reality is that these cuts, this failure, is harming the overall impact, the quality of education that our students are experiencing on the campuses. So while this report talked about the 400 folks that were laid off, the non-faculty folks that were laid off at Chicago State, there were a lot of faculty that were also laid off at Chicago State. There's been faculty laid off at Eastern. There's been faculty laid off at Western Illinois, including tenure track and tenured faculty at Western Illinois. These are happening there, but our students are also walking with their feet. They come onto the campuses and they see deteriorating infrastructure, maintenance deferred to large amounts, that they see bathrooms literally closed on floors, so they have to go to a different bathroom or a different building to go to the bathroom. Elevators not working, holes in the ground where construction started. So it's time that we stop being afraid to talk about the real implication that this is having. This is devastating what was once one of the greatest institutional or higher educational systems in the country. We have an amazing research institution, bucked by two other counter research institutions at the north and the south. We also have amazing regional institutions that serve general population of students and help them achieve their dreams and their potentials, and supported by a very strong community college system. But at the present moment, we seem to be losing that. Our students are walking with their feet, they're not afraid. So it's not enough just to have a budget. It's not enough to say we want funding levels at fiscal 15. We need to have a significant investment in higher education, not just in the infrastructure, but in the actual institutions themselves. So that when we say we need $1 billion for our students to be able to achieve, to have their MAP funding, we ask for $1 million. because that's a $1 billion. That's the way that we're going to achieve it. I know it may not be the politically correct thing to say, and I understand that the challenges and the legislative policies that make it difficult in Springfield to be able to advocate for what we actually need to be advocating for. But we need to advocate for it because our students, our futures, our economy deserves that advocacy. And I appreciate the work that many are doing on this board who are doing it. And I also appreciate the challenges that many have trying to balance it out. I talked to many university presidents, or talked to them, I understand the challenge that they are when they say, well, we can't go very hard out there because we're afraid we're going to lose students and push them out. I get that PR challenge. But we owe it to the future of our students that we say enough is enough. We must have full funding at a level that allows our students to achieve the economic impact and the long-term civil challenges that our students deserve and need. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
That raised up another
point.
You would
want
to share?
Sure. I hope you all heard that. If you want.
Hopefully everyone can hear. And for the sake of time, I want to make sure that you all have a chance to ask questions. So are there any questions right now already out there in the audience that you'd like to ask our panelists?
Can I say one thing?
Sure.
That I think that I'm listening to this, and it's been very helpful to me. I think, just to put this in perspective, I think it helps. I think historically, members of the General Assembly have always seen the representatives that represent the college towns as the people that were in charge of higher ed. And this isn't an editorial comment, this is just an observation. So if you were Dan Brady in ISU, he was the guy that knew about ISU and cared about ISU. And in reality, what you're all saying, and is rightly so, and I like the argument, is that, and obviously the answer is that this is obviously a state issue, but I think the reality is it's their little pockets of what's happening. Those are the reps that people look to, when obviously it's bigger and broader and deeper than just that. But that's what goes on in the General Assembly, is that you go to Brady when you have a question about, or Chapin Rose at Champaign or Noreen Hammond, and that has to change. And I think there's nothing good about what we're going through, okay? I'm not about to sit here and say anything's good, but what I do think is happening and needs to happen is that the whole General Assembly, as they listen to this, and I hope they are, understands that there are broader implications and it impacts them. And obviously it does, because they've all got students going to schools, but I don't think that's been the case. So I'm sorry, I think that's how it's
been.
That's
a good, very good point. We had a young, we do have a microphone going around. The lady in the middle of the table had her hand up right away. Go ahead. Pardon? Oh, there's a microphone there for you to help.
I see, okay. My question is really to Tom Cross. And you are a former legislator. Your current position was an appointment by our current governor. And based on those two facts, what role do you think and believe you personally can play in bridging the divide between our current governor and the Illinois General Assembly for increased funding for higher education in Illinois?
If I had that answer, I wouldn't be here, probably. I would. I'd be.
No, the principles. You know the principles. You were a minority leader, not just a legislator.
I understand. I do know that. Look. I think we're all struggling in this state from all perspectives, whether you're in a social service, you're in K-12, you're in higher ed, you're in the manufacturing business, you're a union leader, you're an advocate for more taxes, less taxes, whatever. We're all struggling to find that answer. I very much would like to be involved in bringing this to closure. I think it's a complete mess. I think it's harming the state. I think it's harm that's going to take a very long time to recover from, and not just in the world of higher education. So I've met with the governor, I've met with the speaker, I've met with the president, I've met with all the leaders, and it gets very frustrating in my role as a citizen, as in my role as the chair of higher ed. You've got two very strong personalities who both believe they are right, who I believe are kind of wed to where they are, and I think it's going to be very, very difficult for them to change their minds. And that's an observation. Again, I'm not going to try not to make editorial comments as the chairman of the Board of Higher Ed, but I think it's going to be very, very tough. Now, I think we had an interesting action as of yesterday, where the Attorney General of the state of Illinois is maybe positioning the courts to say that we may not pay state employees, and that'll create a crisis. And I don't like the idea of a crisis solving a problem, because that hurts people. People will be hurt, and they're already being hurt. But I think it may be a point where either K through 12 doesn't get funded, and schools don't open, or state workers don't get funded, and that may bring everything to a head. And that may be what it takes.
We have another.
Yeah, I'm not encouraging a crisis.
We have a question over here. Woman in red, hi. Yes.
My name is Veronica Cable, I'm state representative. I live in Evanston, so I represent the North Shore. My background, thank you, Ralph and Danielle. I really appreciated this presentation. My background's human services, but I came today to learn more about higher ed, because we are responsible for all of the state. And I know that the legislature and the governor have, we all see the same problem, we just have different solutions, particularly around how to grow our economy. And so I think it was very interesting to hear that one of the ways to really grow our economy is to fund higher education. I also found that California had only reduced their funding of higher education by 3%. They are always thrown up to say, well, look what California cut higher ed during their difficulties. So that's why we're doing it. But clearly, we've cut it as a much, much higher rate than they have. So I really appreciate this. I think that that, as you know, that every crisis has an opportunity. And I think this is going to be an opportunity for us to really put together the kind of budget that we need in Illinois. We are the fifth wealthiest state. There is no reason for us to be 49th in terms of taking care of our people with disabilities and our people with mental illness and other issues. So I think that we need to propose a budget that we think will move Illinois to be the great state that it can be, and propose that kind of a budget and come up with the kind of funding that we need, which we clearly have in this state, as Ralph has said, as the fifth wealthiest state. So I need to run, but thank you all so very much.
Thank you for being here. We have a question in the back, the gentleman in gray.
Thank you. My name is Rich Darga. I'm Dean of Library Instruction Services at Chicago State. And I just want to make a couple comments, if I could. One is that I think this excellent article should be sent to the Tribune to be published in its entirety. This is a well-done report. Thank you. Very interesting, very informative, and it really shows what's going on. And number two, just getting back to our Chicago State is not closing. And that is that's one of the problems that we have with respect to our being out front there, being in the front line with the needs and the particular population we serve. And I just want to mention about those 97 freshmen. It's about half the size as last year. But I see those not as, oh, poor freshmen, they have to go to Chicago State. It's like they were some brave students. With all the rumors that were out there about us closing, we took a hit with 400 employees being laid off permanently, basically. Mm-hmm. And that was a huge reduction in our expenses. So we've been able to retool and redefine who we are and what we're doing. And I think we've got a pretty solid future ahead of us. So that's a rumor I want to dispel.
Did you have a question as well?
No, I just had some comments.
Okay. this gentleman back here has a question.
Easy on the panel. Thank you. Hello, my name is Jay Lubinsky. I'm emeritus professor at Governor State University. My question is, who cares? I don't mean that as a facetious question. I mean it as an empirical question. The spending of money, Ms. Martiri mentioned earlier, there's no way to see this kind of spending as rational, and of course it's not. But any recent book on behavioral economics will show you that people don't spend rationally. People spend emotionally. So my question is, who cares? In Illinois, in the state of Illinois, What is the perception of higher education across the state, outside of those towns that are college towns, as you mentioned, because they have a constituency? And there's a key, because politicians and the people who approve our budgets will listen to their constituents. But are their constituents contacting them and saying, we care about higher education? And even if they care about higher education, where is it in their list of priorities? We need an emotional base. How do we do that? We now have a president who said during his campaign, I love people who don't have college education. And so there's a populist support for that from the very highest office in our country. How do we overcome that? First of all, do we have data on the amount of caring in the populace of Illinois? Second, corollary to that, do we have data about where that falls in people's needs in their daily lives?
I'm going to toss that one to Kyle.
Sure.
I think you have experience in K-12 as well. What understanding do you have of this?
And let me just finish it up. If we collect the data and the data show that people don't care much or care a little, how do we get them to care, and how do we then get them to contact their legislators so that the legislators support the budgetary needs for higher education in the state? Thank you.
So I'll talk a little bit about who cares right now, and then I think who will care very soon. The folks that care most about this issue are, I was sitting at a table and met a young man named Dominique, who was a first generation student that had gone to University of Illinois in Springfield, graduated, came back to Chicago, and now is working down the street at a public relations firm. He had to leave a little while ago. Who cares are people like him and his family, for whom the power of a college degree has radically transformed his family and himself and his family's economic prospects. So there's a constituency of folk for whom that this issue is very real, for whom the cost of going to college has continued to increase. Their student loan debt rate, as Danielle had pointed out, has continued to increase over the years, and for whom the state of Illinois, it will no longer be a good, viable option for going to college. So as long as we continue this crisis, University of Iowa is excited about this, because they are poaching students from the state of Illinois to go to the University of Iowa at in-state tuition rates, because they know that we can't get our act together. So there are families who depend and are looking at a college education as a viable means to improve themselves. There are students that are looking at it the same way. And then in the near term, we're going to see our business community begin to care about this as their pipeline for talent, both entry-level talent and graduate level, sort of returning talent for their existing and incumbent employees who are seeking to advance with MBAs, et cetera, they're going to begin to care. That hasn't become quite as pressing quite yet. But it will, as universities continue to have to shrink their course catalogs and continue to have to eliminate academic course programs and make hard decisions because they don't have a budget. That will have a direct impact on the businesses that have either relocated to the state of Illinois because saw a very healthy and viable higher education system to sustain their businesses in the long run. As that system continues to shrink and as that system continues to undergo these really tumultuous times, they'll care as well, because it will ultimately impact their bottom line and their ability to sustain the talent within their companies. But right now, the folks that care the most, I think, are the folks that have benefited the most from public education in the state of Illinois, and that is poor and working class students for whom our state institutions have been the sort of way up and the way out of poverty and the way way towards a long-term situation, a long-term standing in the middle class.
Mm-hmm. John wants to add.
Yeah, I want to add just a little bit. That's a great question about who cares and the nature of why would people care. And I would suspect that the vast majority of people actually do care. They just don't know how to mobilize themselves and move towards an action. And the reason why I say that is that about on average, we're closing in now on a graduating student in Illinois at $30,000 worth of debt. So imagine your career starting out these days at $30,000 already in debt. This is not buying a car. This is not being able to rent an apartment. This is staying at home with mom and dad. And we're seeing more and more students who are graduating with good degrees staying at home with their folks because they financially cannot get out. In the state of Illinois, we hold as a whole as a state over $50 billion in debt. Student debt alone, $50 billion. Let that sink in for a few seconds and ask yourself how many folks in here still are currently earning debt or are paying off student debt? And what is the impact that that has had on your choices? And imagine now that being monumentally increased by the lack of MAP funding that is occurring that we're not able to afford and help those students who need it the most being able to reach their achievements. But I would also say let's not discount those university towns because those university towns are economic engines in this area. And we are watching many of these university towns closing up and closing doors. It might be simply the pet walker, who the person who takes care of the dogs or will walk your dog during the day while you're on vacation. That business closed in Macomb. It could be the small gas station in the city of Charleston that is closing up. It could be down in Carbondale. It could be any one of the small little delis that are right around the universities, not just in the small towns, but also at all these institutions that are struggling because people do not have pocket change left to afford these type of things. But it's also with the university faculty and academic staff that's walking out of the universities. They're leaving. There is numerous evidence to substantiate that the number of folks who teach in our institutions are leaving the state. They're either retiring earlier or they are packing up and leaving out altogether because of the uncertainty of their future. And I think so that's what it is. The challenge is how do we mobilize people and get them to actually act and put the pressure on it? Because this is a crisis by choice. Let us not forget that. We don't have to be in this situation. And any level, but we have decided and we've chosen to be in this crisis of choice. And it's time for us to say that we are no longer accepting this choice. I am a co-founder of what is known as Fund Our Future Illinois, which is an organization, a coalition of many different groups that are fighting for MAP funding for our students and trying to decrease the cost of tuition rates as a whole. Last year, we turned in over 25,000 postcards from students, parents across this entire state in every legislative district. We produced that again. We now have 40 to 50,000 postcards out, and we're still getting them in on the same thing. People care about this issue. We need to direct and we need to say that the folks can make a difference. You know, we can walk away from the current election with many different perspectives, but I think one of the perspectives we need to do is that people can make a difference.
Ralph?
Yeah, so I agree that people care. It's just they don't realize it. And so you have to get them to think about it in the front of their head. So why do I say that? A couple of years back in the good old days of a $5 billion deficit, we were able to get a statewide poll question asked. And we wanted to test the environment for a tax increase. So we said, all right, state of Illinois has a $5 billion deficit. What should it do to solve its problems? Simple question, cut spending or raise taxes? So, literally 60% of the state almost, 58, said cut spending, of course, government spending, cut that. Very few people, 33, 34% said raise taxes. Our next question, all right, if you voted to cut spending, here's how the state spends its money. Pick your $5 billion in cuts, or you could change your vote and say raise taxes. And we went from somewhere in the low 30% of the state saying raise taxes to almost 70% of the state saying raise taxes. People don't understand what the state spends its public sector money on. And they don't understand. But once they do, I care about higher ed. I care about K-12. I care about social services to vulnerable populations. So no, I don't want to cut any of those things. I guess I'll pay more in taxes. So it goes back to my comment. You have to change the conversation. You have to get people to recognize this is something they value and they support. You got to activate them because they do. In fact, the polling data indicate they do support it. They're just not activated on it. Say we got to get the general population activated. And I think Tom was exactly right, and activated in communities that aren't university communities. You know, we really have to show that this is something that impacts Austin, Maywood, Bellwood, Peoria, East St. Louis, Marion, and it does. And so it's really getting a different message out so that the voters can then mobilize and push their elected officials to be on board. Mm-hmm.
Other questions?
Yeah, but I think this is a brilliant question, though. Everyone cares if you ask them. The question is, right, the question is, are they going to get... Bingo, irritated enough to make a difference, and we're not at that point yet. And I do think you grab any person on the street, of course I care about higher ed, and here's why, I mean, generally speaking, but like I said, if we didn't open up K-12 schools, I think you'd have a revolution, you know, a mini revolution, and we're not at that point here on higher ed yet. I'm sitting here listening to all this, if you're in a college town, you were probably in Chapin's ear or Noreen's in a big way, but that's not happening to a suburban legislator or city legislator, I think. So I think you raise a great point, a real challenge for people here, the Board of Higher Ed and others that care. How do we take it to an entirely different level? Because we're not there. I don't believe yet. And I know that sounds crazy because we're in a crisis mode, but from a political standpoint, I think you're right.
Is the Board of Higher Ed having conversations with legislators right now about this, trying to get them to care?
Yes. There's also a coalition that is made up of all kinds of groups. That there's a rally on February 8th in Springfield.
Great.
So there are a lot of people. There are really two people that we really need to be talking to.
Right. Exactly. Gentlemen?
Good morning, everyone. Luis Narvaez, PhD student at Illinois State University. Great panel discussion. Thank you so much. A quick comment on what Kyle mentioned. All you have to do is drive down the Tri-State Tollway and see all the billboards from out-of-state colleges recruiting our students. Having someone in my family who's a high school senior, he's not thinking about going to school here in the state of Illinois because of everything that we saw. So we're losing that talent. He's going to go to Ann Arbor or Des Moines or what have you. He's going to fall in love with that state and that city, and he's not going to come back. His tax dollars aren't going to come back either. And I see you're agreeing with that. And then a quick question, if any of you have any information on it. I've been part of a working group trying to pass the student access bill in Springfield. We haven't had much luck. The student access bill would allow for state universities to provide financial assistance to undocumented immigrant students who right now do not qualify for any state or federal financial assistance. With the state of affairs in Springfield, I don't see a possibility of helping out the students who in Chicago at least make up 10% of the graduating class, allow them top of their class, high scores, but don't have the financial means to attend college. Is there any hope for this one population in the state of affairs that we have right now, or is this a pretty much lost cause right now?
I hope it's not a lost cause. I think these issues like this never happen as quickly as we want. I think the driver's license bill for undocumented folks did not pass initially, and this, after time it did. And I think legislators saw politically that it was not harmful to them. And that's how they think, how we think. And so I hope that bill passes, but I just sometimes, it's one of those things that may need a little more time. But hopefully it will.
That's anyone else familiar with that bill that wants to? Anyone else? No? Okay. Gentleman up front here. Right here.
I did want to make a couple of comments. I don't imagine there is a legislative district in the state that does not have a community college or a university or an independent school. Independent college. So all of those legislators should care, and they should be, part of being a legislator is doing some education. We had a president who was very patient and tried to educate us, but we all can be educated. It's not just always political pressure. Another comment, MAP funds. You're right on, Chairperson Cross. I would like to see, in fact, I argued at a Board of Higher Ed meeting that we ought to be doubling MAP funds, because MAP funds get students in the door, and cutting MAP funds is discriminatory as can be, because it's poor students, it's students of color. You get students in the door, they have to bring money with them. So $1 billion of MAP money is going to bring probably $5 or $6 or more billion into higher education. You can't go to school without additional money, whether it's your, you know, part-time work, some parent help, and so on and so forth. So I'm all for MAP funds, and I do want to recognize that our independent schools have been terribly hurt. You go down, Roosevelt University is about 9 or 10% less this year. Robert Morris, City College, they're down probably 6% in enrollment. Probably because they can't eat the MAP money that's no longer there. They recognized it last year. They said, okay, well, you know, we'll take care of you. But they can't do it anymore. So students are moving. And so MAP money is critical. And of course, that's important for our independent schools.
Another question up front here. There's a gentleman with a question. You've got a question. Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
Actually,
she's got the
microphone. I appreciate the panel discussion. My name is Chris Wiseman. I am the immediate past president of St. Xavier University on the south side of Chicago. I am the president of the Federation of Independent Illinois Colleges and Universities. There are 60 members of us. And I am also a member of the Illinois Board of Higher Education. I want to reinforce the comments about collaboration and about coalition. Several years ago, I think it is true that higher education lost control of the conversation. The conversation was usurped by everyone else. The other thing that happened is that higher education lost its leverage in the legislature. But one of the things that higher education is very good at is building coalitions, particularly with business. All of us encourage businesses to come onto our campuses, to be involved with our students. St. Xavier University is well over 50% non-white. It has a population that is 72% first generation, and its graduation rates over 55%, and within the last 7 years of my tenure, there were some 9,000 degrees conferred on the students in Illinois. We are about 92% in-state resident. But I think that it is critical to continue building the coalitions. All politics is local. And in some of the districts that do not immediately have community colleges or colleges, independent or public universities, business needs to become part of that coalition. Business is hurting. We've all got anecdotal stories about people who talk about all of the applicants who come to them, and they talk about the various credentials that the applicants have. But who do they hire? They hire the people with the college degrees, which reinforces the data that we've just heard. So I think that is what I would like to hear us talk about. How do we build those coalitions with business, with the enterprises that are local, but also have statewide appeal? Because in doing that, we will also support and give greater voice, I think, to higher education. So that's my question.
How do we build coalitions?
So I think it's important to build coalitions, and I'm a member of the coalition that you're referring to through the partnership that we have with the Illinois Federation of Teachers. We also have Fund Our Future coalitions and the like. But I want to caution something. One of the things that we have consistently been talking about here is the role higher ed, and I know that was part of the framing of this, is the role higher ed has in economic growth and economic economic development. But I think we want to be very careful to make sure that we are also preparing students for a lifelong learning, that it's not about just graduating a student who can get job X. It's about graduating the student who can get job M 6 years from now. Because I don't know about anybody else on this panel, but I can tell you that I think I am now in my fifth or fourth, six different careers since leaving the university, from since graduating from as an undergraduate, that's kind of where I've moved through a nature. I would suspect most of us are, most data suggests that. So I want to be very cautious that we are not just trying to tee up and create the aims with higher education with the immediate needs of a particular business and the like. I think that's a very dangerous trend, and we lose our ability to argue effectively on that when we do. So we can't just have business coalitions into that. Additionally, we need to recognize the importance that higher education plays in social justice and the importance of a civil society, so that when we are seeing programs being cut like we did at Western, philosophy, religious studies, ethics, women's studies, African American studies, we see those proposals being drained out now at Eastern Illinois University. We see proposals of that nature now being proposed at, or at least I should say that they are looking at every department at Governor State University. We see similar concepts being laid out at Northern Illinois University, because there is this immense pressure to produce jobs, but we need to be producing citizens. And that's how we also change this. And I think we have lost that argument. We've got to be cautious about the coalitions that we form, so that when we form coalitions, that important message isn't lost.
Tom?
I totally agree with you. I think the coalitions and the input from the businesses has to be very substantive. It can't just be, hey, thanks for coming in and being an advisory board. I'll give you a quick example. I work at Aurora University, and some other people did it, so I'll brag about it. They created a STEM school on campus for third through eighth graders, and it's not a gifted program, and it's made up of East Aurora, West Aurora, Indian Prairie, and Batavia. Districts that struggle, districts that don't struggle. We get 50 kids from the four school districts. The park scores are off the charts. But what they did, and they raised money to build the facility. But what the brilliance of what they did was, they went to Exline and Caterpillar and Nicor and said, "Thanks for your money, but we want your intellectual capital." And what they did is, they for a year they sat in a room with teachers from those school districts, the AU faculty, and the business community, and developed a curriculum. And the business folks said, "We didn't know how hard it was to teach." And the teachers said, "We weren't sure what you were looking for people that were eventually going to be hired." They said, "We hire bright people, but they don't know how to work together. They don't have to solve problems. They don't know how to be creative thinkers." That STEM school today, they're nailing it on park scores. We're in our third year. Every classroom continues to have a business partner, a not-for-profit, a faculty member, and obviously a teacher. And what the business community has said to us, we give money to schools, whether it's colleges, great, you know, high schools, and they put us on advisory panels, and then just to shut us up. If you ask them to come to the table and stay at the table, and you build that coalition, then it's invaluable. The other thing they did at the STEM school is it has become a community project. The mayor was involved, the city council was involved, the chamber of commerce was involved. When we had to pass legislation in Springfield, and the woman that put this together did a good job talking to the local union representatives. So when we got some pushback in Springfield because we thought it was a charter school, the local union folks said, no, we're at the table, we're working with the STEM school. So then you have a community investment, and you have a community coalition. And so if somebody said, Aurora's not gonna be there, the STEM school's not gonna be there, you have a whole lot of people saying, wait a minute, that's wrong. And that's the beauty of a real coalition, Christine. And I think that's something, it's a little different way to think. The teachers only come for 2 to 4 years, then they have to go back to their respective schools. So they'll be champions talking about STEM and a different way to teach. So I think the coalition idea is statewide is brilliant. Yeah, go ahead.
And the only thing I would add is just tacking on, sort of adding on to the last part of what you said about businesses wanting critical thinkers, they want communicators, they want folks that know how to work together. That's the heart of obviously a college education. And I think we often get in these conversations about sort of educating, sort of bringing the business community into the conversation, as if the businesses just want folks to learn how to turn a dial, or they just want folks who are very narrowly trained in something very technical. And the conversations that I've had, and I know that you've had and others have had, is that's important, but the more important thing is the critical thinking. And so I think we have to be careful of this false dichotomy that we create when we talk about coalition building, particularly with the business community, and be sensitive to the fact that the kinds of skills and sort of attributes that are going to be successful in the workplace will transcend whatever particular industry is at the table, whether it be ComEd, People's Gas, or whether it be Accenture, et cetera. I think we just have to be careful about not creating this false dichotomy about the skills for life and the skills for work.
Yeah, and so just the simple part of it, it's not an either or, it's a both and, right? And I think, and then that's how you move a political agenda forward. Although as far as moving careers, I work on tax policy in Illinois, so I think I'm employed the next 300 years as far as I can tell.
I think though it's important to understand that policy needs to follow that.
Yeah.
That policy shouldn't be looking at funding X business or X community college or X program because it produces X job. And I think sometimes I get a little nervous with some of the stuff that I hear coming out of Springfield that seems to move in that direction. But I do want to point out one of the things is that look at the programs that are being eliminated. Look at the programs that are being increased in terms of enrollment, decreasing or increasing the reliance on adjuncts without this proper support that those adjuncts need. And where are they? They're in the general humanities and the arts. And what are those teach? Critical strategic thinking.
We had a question up here. I wanted to get him a chance to ask. Where's the microphone? Oh, sorry. Do you want to ask yours really quick and then we'll go to you for the last question? I'm sorry.
Sure, thank you. My name's Tim Love. I work here at Loyola. I'm the Associate Dean of Students. I've been a part of some of the MAP advocacy efforts. I think that, you know, Loyola University, like all of us here, recognize the importance of MAP funding, especially as a civil rights issue, as a social justice issue, which our university holds as a central value. My question has to do with sort of a gap in the conversation that I'd like to ask the panelists to sort of fill for me, to help me in those efforts. In reaching out to certain legislators, I've found that the, sort of the counter narrative, at least part of it, is that universities can do better to be more efficient with the resources that they have and thus be able to assist students and make a dollar go a little bit further. I want to be clear with an asterisk, caveat, whatever, that I agree 100% with everything that's been said today and the importance of all of these issues. Obviously, we need more money, et cetera. I'm wondering, though, what's your response for the folks who say, you know, look at the skyrocketing costs of education, the administrative bloat, so to speak. That counter narrative is out there and I think is an important one for us to be prepared to address knowledgeably with facts, et cetera. And I haven't always felt prepared to handle those responses. I'm just wondering if you could speak to what are universities doing to ensure that they're being the most efficient that they can possibly be with the dollars that they have, given the compliance regulatory issues and all the other stuff that is, you know, increasing burdens on higher education as an enterprise overall. I'd appreciate that side of the story.
Yeah.
I'll take that one. So I can't speak for every university. I know what we've done. I know when President Colleen came in, one of the first things he did was cut the university administration by like $15 million. So I would say that, again, I guess to what you said, like both of those things are true, right? There is bloat, there is excess, and I think the best thing that universities can do is realistically like take a look at what we are spending, look at our budget, and similar, you know, take some of the same steps that we're asking the state to take, right? Our budget is a moral document. Where are we spending our money at? What can we cut? What legitimately can we cut? And what do we need to increase spending on? As far as I guess for those who say that making cuts to the universities is okay, and it's problematic, right? Because if we take a realistic look at what's happening in the universities, then I think we understand that the most marginalized folks in the state really don't have access to the institutions now. And realistically, it costs more money to educate those individuals. Now, again, if we're saying we're moving forward, we want to change the state of things, right? Then what we're saying is we want to give access to those individuals. I would think in turn that it would the cost to educate those individuals would require that we need to spend more money in education.
Yeah, if I could just 2 seconds on that.
Yeah.
So I'm going to wear my former hat. Before I took Center for Tax and Budget Accountability, I was a private sector. I did mergers and acquisitions, structured finance, and intellectual property. I was an evil corporate lawyer, and I was, frankly, pretty good at it. So I think this efficiency argument is entirely misplayed, especially when it's applied to education. You are not more efficient educating students, either at higher ed or K-12, with greater class size and less teachers. Cost less. You're not more efficient at accomplishing your goal of educating. Education is and should remain labor intensive. Folks just have to understand that. You have to look at your efficiency metrics in context of what your anticipated outcomes or desired outcomes are, and then design an efficient system to accomplish that. And the efficient system may be more expensive than the one you have now. And that's what gets to the capacity aspect of this, right? So I think one of the most brilliant things done in American politics has been the move of some on the right, beginning with Grover Norquist and continuing on, to starve the public sector. Because what they understood is that if the public sector has inadequate resources, it will be generating over time inadequate outcomes. And then you could then go back to the voter and taxpayer and say things like, well, do you really want to spend more tax money on that inefficient organization called government or public universities which aren't generating the outcomes you want anyway? Well, no, I don't want to. No one ever looks at it in context. So I really want to reinforce the argument that we have to change the discussion. We have to make it abundantly clear that yes, this is a good economic thing to do. It also makes people prepared to be contributors to a modern democracy, et cetera, et cetera. And spending the money on it on the front end is in your interest. It's in your interest, because on the back end, your state's economy will be better, there will be less civil violence, there'll be more access to opportunity for everyone, including people trying to escape poverty, et cetera, et cetera. It's a win-win-win. So it's a both and, it's not an either or, and it's a change of the argument to get people to understand the value associated with making appropriate investment on the front.
A quick follow-up, and then we're going to get to the gentleman over here for the last question. But Ralph, you know, we've talked a lot about funding in K-12, and there's a big discussion around evidence-based modeling with the school funding formula. And I'm just curious if there's any discussion about the extension of that into higher education as a way to increase funding for higher education by tying some, you know, evidence-based outcomes to.
It would be different because of the very different type of academic programming provided at that next level. So what you're not doing at that next level is preparing students like K-12 is to show a certain amount of substantive knowledge that can be measured and assessed.
Right.
What you are trying to do is make them become critical thinkers, problem solvers. We've used all these tools so that they can be successful contributing members, not just to the economy, but to our democracy.
Right.
So there are, of course, practices that can be implemented at the higher ed level that promote critical thinking and lateral thought and all that other stuff, but there's not an evidence-based cost approach to those practices. There's a lot of different ways to get there. So really, the evidence that you would utilize that bridges ideological divides when it comes to higher education is the evidence on return on investment and reduction in poverty rates and all the other stuff.
Is
sort of the evidence that justifies the added investment in from a taxpayer's.
Okay, thank you. And sir, I'm sorry, it took a while to get to you, but there's the microphone.
In your visuals, you present unemployment rates, average incomes, and probably some other variables for community college graduates, among other completion levels. And that doesn't differentiate between graduates of academic and vocational programs in the community colleges. How do you think those statistics would compare between those two groups?
Actually, if you looked at the slide, the associate's degree was included with the some college slash associate's degree category, and that data is sometimes singled out. But you'll see that even in the graphic there. So it is singled out there, the associate's degree. But the important thing to note about an associate's degree is it is a powerful way to credential a future worker to the point where they will have a job that pays a wage that grows at a rate greater than inflation over time. So there is that correlation there. So it's a real positive correlation. It's not as powerful as it is as a BA, just like a BA isn't as powerful as a professional degree. So further on the educational attainment ladder you go, the better the economic outcomes for you overall on average. But that data is segregated out in there, and you'll see.
Well, thank you all. Thank you to the panelists. Thanks to everyone for coming. And I will hand it over to Ralph for the closing remarks.
Yeah, you know, closing remarks, I'm going to keep it brief because we promised to get people out of here on a timely basis. We want to be respectful. The first thing I do want to do is thank Loyola University again for this facility and everyone for helping out and getting here. It's a great facility and really you were incredibly cooperative. I have to acknowledge the work of Addison. You know, Addison, wave your hand. You drove this entire event, and so I really want to thank you and all the effort you did. Board of Directors has shown out in force here today, and I want to thank them for supporting the center and our focus on taking on these big systems change issues, which don't really show success maybe overnight, but you stay with us and you continue to support us. You know, moving forward, I think everything that we've discussed today has to be put in context of our overall state's capacity. $750 billion state economy. Yet despite that size, the one thing that Governor Rauner says all the time that is technically accurate is that our economy has fallen behind the rest of the nation in percentage growth over time. And when you start isolating out the reasons for that failure, you start seeing it has everything to do with a lack of investment in things like education and infrastructure, and nothing to do with tax policy. And so we, as more informed individuals, have to make that case on a consistent basis to folks in both parties who I think can support this on a bipartisan basis, this meaning a rational solution. I think long term, we need to start asking elected officials a different question. We need to look them in the eye and say, all right, defend to me the state's disinvestment in higher ed. Defend that to me. Defend to me the fact that the state of Illinois ranks 50th in the nation in the portion of K-12 funding it covers. Defend that. Defend to me the disinvestment in social services, so that entire network is rapidly disappearing. People with developmental disabilities, mental health problems, abused and neglected children, single working parents that need childcare are not getting the support they need to improve their lives. Defend to me a state whose decisions on tax and fiscal policy not only disinvest in education generally, all the way from K through 20, but have singled out minorities for particularly poorly funded K-12 educations and loss of resources to go on and do better. If you, legislator, governor, can't defend those policy decisions you are making to me, then change them. Change them in a manner that this state should have the resources it needs to invest in the services its population demands. Period. I think that changes the discussion. Thank you.
Thanks for coming. Thank you.